Welcome back to Hungry for History. In today's episode, we are going to make an ancient Egyptian bread. Last year, during the pandemic, Seamus Blackley, who is a physicist and a game designer, best known for creating the Xbox, revived 4,500-year-old dormant yeast samples from ancient Egyptian baking vessels. He successfully baked a loaf in an earthen pit, similar to the way the Egyptians baked in the time of pyramids. Recently, while I was doing research about bread production in ancient Egypt, I find an illustration of bread making scene from the tomb of Ramses III, who was the second pharaoh of the 20th dynasty. It presents the workflow of the pharaoh's royal bakery. All the workers in the bakery are men working in teams, completing the individual processes leading to bread production. The scene illustrates workers transferring and storing jars, preparing the dough, and cutting the dough into bread loaves. It also shows a variety of bread sizes and shapes. They have bread loaves in disc, cones, oval, bagel, and animal shapes. I find the spiral one the most interesting, partly because of the unique shape, which reminds me of cinnamon rolls, and partly due to the cooking method involved. I'm going to recreate the spiral-shaped bread in today's video. Let's get it started! The original drawing of the bread-making scene has been partially destroyed by floods, and it does not come with any inscription explaining the bread production. So my interpretation of the bread-making scene relies on works of two Egyptologists, John Gardner Wilkinson and Adolf Ehrman. Wilkinson was a 19th century traveler and scholar. He was a pioneer of Egyptology, that is, the modern science devoted to the study of ancient Egypt. Adolf Ehrman was a renowned German Egyptologist in the late 19th century. Wilkinson and Ehrman offer some insight about how the spiral bread was made in the royal bakery. In Ramses III's bakery, bread was made by mixing the dough, kneading it with both hands, or with the feet, in a large container. I'm not going to knead the dough with my feet for my Egyptian bread recipe, just let you know. Ehrman suggests that the long poles were used to help workers jump with more strength. Wilkinson believes that after the workers finish kneading the dough, they left the dough to ferment in a basket, which also means that the dough might contain certain wild yeast. In the next part of the scene, we see two people carrying two different kinds of jars. One has a narrow neck, likely for liquid. It could be water or honey. Water is necessary in bread making, and Egyptians use honey to sweeten their bread. The other jar was for storing the bread dough. Similar shaped jars were featured in drawings of bread making scenes discovered in other Egyptian tombs. Two people were engaged in making the spiral bread. After they formed the bread, they used two sticks to hold the bread and cook it in a large wok. Here comes confusion. Some Egyptologists suggest the bread was boiled in water before being baked in the oven nearby. A similar technique called a water bath is also used in making pretzel and bagels today. Some Egyptologists believe that the bread was actually fried in oil in that large wok. So for my Egyptian bread recipe, I decided to try out both methods. But there is another problem. What ingredients are used in producing the bread? Since there is no accompanying inscription, it's hard to tell what kind of wheat flour the bakers use just by looking at the drawings. By studying the components of bread excavated from ancient Egyptian tombs, scholars have discovered that ancient Egyptians made bread from barley and emmerwait. But by New Kingdom times, emmerwait has been the grain of choice for bread. Emmerwait is little grown today, but it has a very ancient history. It was one of the first cereals to be domesticated in the Old World. In Egypt, though, emmer remained the wheat of choice until the end of the pharaonic period. Archaeologists also find that bread loaves discovered from ancient tombs contained cooked but unground cereal grains, which could have been either inadvertently included or deliberately added. Egyptians also added flavorings to their bread, such as herbs, spices like coriander seeds, eggs, animal fat, and sweeteners like honey, dates, figs, and other dried fruits. To recreate the spiral bread, I used emmerwait as the main ingredient. I bought 2 pounds of amaranth berries and wanted to grind my own flour. When you look for amaranth to buy, be careful with the term farro. In the US, farro refers to any one of three ancient wheat grains: iron, corn, amaranth, or spelt. Check an ingredient on the package label to make sure what you get is amaranth, not the other two. I don't have a stone mortar or grain mill, so I ground amaranth in my magic bullet blender. It took me a few times to get a relatively fine flour. After I finished grinding each time, I poured the flour into a sieve over a bowl and gently sift the flour through. Then poured the remain in the sieve back and to the blender again. The resulting flour is a bit coarse compared to store-bought flour. I noticed there is some chaff in the flour, which is fine to me, adding more fiber to my diet. Since the dough was left to ferment, I will use a sourdough starter to introduce the yeast to the bread and let the dough ferment. To make the spiral bread, I use the following ingredients: 1/2 cup active sourdough starter, 1 cup water, 2 tablespoons of honey, 2 teaspoons of fine sea salt, 4 cups of amaranth flour. Here is how I made the spiral bread. In a bowl, mix together the starter, water, honey, and salt with a spatula. Add the amaranth flour, use the spatula to bring the ingredients together as best as you can. Originally, I planned to use my KitchenAid mixer to knead the dough, but after I put all the ingredients in the bowl and installed the dough hook, and I realized that we had the wrong size hook. My husband was gifted with a mixer years ago, and neither of us had used the dough hook to make bread before. So what should I do? I knead the dough by hand on the countertop for a few minutes until my hands get really tired, and then my husband took over. If you had a mixer with a dough hook, mix the dough on the lowest speed for about 6 to 7 minutes. When the dough became smooth and pliable, I shaped it into a ball and returned it into the bowl and covered the bowl with a towel. I let the dough rest at room temperature for about 12 hours. After 12 hours, the dough doubled in size, but the top formed a thin dry crust. I took the dough out and attempted to incorporate the dry crust by kneading, but the crust was too hard to blend in, so I sprinkled some water to moisten the dough. After a couple minutes, the dough actually became soft enough for me to work with. After kneading for a few minutes, I returned the dough back to the bowl and let it rest for about 30 minutes. After the second rest, I took out the dough and divided it into 8 equal pieces. I took one piece of the dough and rolled it out into a long tube about 1/2 inch in diameter. Then I rolled the tube into a spiral shape and kneaded the end of the tube with the formed bread so that it will not unravel during cooking process. I repeat the same steps to shape the rest of the dough into spirals. Cover the spirals with a towel and let them rest for another 30 minutes until the dough rises a little bit more. I gave 4 of the spirals a water bath first and then baked them in the oven. While the spiral dough is rising, prepare a pot of boiling water at least 3 inches deep with 1 tablespoon of honey. Boil the spirals one at a time for about 1 minute on each side and place them back onto the baking sheet. Preheat the oven to 425 degrees Fahrenheit. Bake the spirals for about 20 minutes or until golden brown on the outside. As for the remaining 4 spirals, I deep fry them with vegetable oil. Pour about 3 cups of vegetable oil into a pot. Heat it over medium heat until it reaches around 350 degrees Fahrenheit. I used a thermometer to make sure the oil temperature was about 350 degrees Fahrenheit. The first spiral bread came out a little burnt as the oil temperature went above 380 degrees Fahrenheit. I was not sure how long each side should take to cook since it was my first time to try out this recipe. The following 3 dough spirals got better as I figured out each side only needs at most 1 minute until the bread turned golden brown. Now it's time to taste the bread. I have the bread in front of me. This one was boiled in water first and baked in the oven. It did not rise nearly as much, probably because the crust was already set when boiled in water. The crust feels hard and dry. And it's hard, actually hard to break. It smells a little bit sour. Let me try a piece. It tastes slightly sweet and a bit nutty and very chewy. I think it will go well with a soup or stew. And as for this one was deep fried in hot vegetable oil. It swelled up with air and a puff-like bloom in the oil. It is softer now after it gets cool. Let me break it open. As you can tell, it is hollow inside. The inside part is actually a little bit crumbly and it's less chewy than the baked one. And it has a slight sour flavor. Actually, this is my first time making bread with amaranth, and I haven't fully grasped the techniques involved in working with this ancient grain. I think I will continue to experiment bread recipes with it, maybe adding honey, figs, dates, and seeds like coriander. I feel excited just by thinking about it. So that's all I have for you today. I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you like today's video, please don't forget to share and subscribe. I will see you next time. Bye bye.